To make sure millions of people are getting paid on time and in compliance, ADP is staying on top of each new piece of legislation. So when it comes down to it, ADP isn't just a payroll and HR company. We're the company that helps you navigate complexity. Learn more at ADP.com.
Live from Southern California, this is the Jim Rome Show.
Lakers beaten by the Wizards last night in OT, 127-124. Now, that in and of itself is not a big problem. I mean, they lost to the Heat on Saturday. Again, that in and of itself, not a reason to panic. But they did lose to the Nets on Thursday night. Again, in and of itself, not a reason to freak out. But when you string those three losses together and you combine them into a three-game losing streak that the Lakers have right now, then it's a little more concerning. And then you take that three-game losing streak and you make that part of them losing four out of five. Then you start to actually grip a little bit, especially when last night's loss did come in overtime. That's a game where they had a 17-point lead in the second half. When you're looking to stop the bleeding, that's something that can't happen, but it did. For instance, you finished that off last night in regulation, and then LeBron does not have to play nearly 16 of the final 17 minutes of that game. You finished that off last night, and then you don't give up even more ground to the Utah Jazz. But they were not able to do so. Again, they're going to be a different team without their second and third leading scorers. That's pretty obvious. Anybody who thought that they wouldn't be. Anybody who thought they could just keep rolling right along without Anthony Davis and Dennis Schroeder was just begging. So the issue is not the fact that they've lost three straight or that they've lost four out of five. What it is they could have used a win last night. That would have been awfully nice. They could have used a win last night, and they were up by 17, and they still couldn't finish. Once again, you finish that game, you get yourself a little breathing room. Finish that game, and then you don't have to answer questions after the game about how it felt to have Bradley Beal stab you in the chest on three straight possessions.
20 turnovers for L.A. Here's Beal now. Got it in his hand. Bradley Beal scores 26 points now for the Wizards off those Laker turnovers.
Three straight possessions, and then followed that up with this circus shot.
Two-point game. Beal and Westbrook going to work. Beal almost lost the handle, gets it back. And wow, what a finish with a left hand by Bradley Beal.
And then he chases that with another bucket for good measure. And then you've got Russell Westbrook jumping in there, ripping the knife out of Beal's hand, and then doing a little carving of his own.
Westbrook to inbound. They get it to Bertans. Now Westbrook has it, and it's got to be a continuation. They knew Westbrook was the guy they wanted to foul. It was a foul by LeBron James.
All right, so at the end of the game, you're looking at Beal, and you're looking at Westbrook. Beal goes 33-7-6. Westbrook goes 32-14-9. That'll happen. Great players will do that. Again, in and of itself, not a reason for Laker fans to panic and start jamming their car flags back into storage. But what I'm saying is this. Pretty much exactly what I said and warned Laker fans about when AD went down. The chance to win number 18 is not gone. It just got tougher, a lot tougher, because the Lakers are now going to have to exert even more energy in the regular season, coming off a short offseason in a year where they're trying to repeat. Repeating as champ again is one of the toughest things to do in all sports. Doing it on a shortened offseason is even tougher. Doing it on a shortened offseason with your second best player dealing with a leg injury makes it really difficult. And now the team has to answer questions about whether or not LeBron is playing too much, whether or not LeBron is carrying too much of a load, something that LeBron obviously does not want to hear about.
I mean, I'm resting now. I'm resting when I get in my car and head home. I'm resting when I get home. I'll rest tomorrow. You know, I think this whole narrative of LeBron needs more rest, so I should take more rest, so I should take time here. It's become a lot bigger than what it actually really is. I've never talked about it. I don't talk about it. I don't believe in it. Fast turnaround from last season, and we all wish we could have more rest. But, you know, I'm here to work, and I'm here to punch my clock in and be available to my teammates. And if I'm hurt or if I'm not feeling well, then we can look at it then. But I have nothing but honest people around me. But I'm also honest with myself as well. me having the love for the game and me being able to be available to my teammates is more important than anything.
So, of course, this guy's not asking out of games or looking for his load to be managed. That's not who he is. That's not how he's wired. But sometimes you do have to protect the guy from the guy, especially that guy. And if you're going to ask that guy to work overtime, you better get a win. Otherwise, you're depreciating that asset even further, and you have nothing to show for it. Because while the Lakers have lost 3 in a row and 4 of 5, the team they're looking up at, the Utah Jazz, are straight abusing fools every single night. And look who LA has to deal with tomorrow night. That's right, the same Utah Jazz. Now, you can't win a championship in February, but you can lose one because you can make the road to that title a lot tougher. Right now, the Lakers would have to beat the Clippers in the playoffs for a chance to face the Jazz, while Utah gets to wait for those two teams to beat the hell out of each other and then take on the battered winner. For the last time, losing last night was not a backbreaker. There is no reason to smash the panic button yet, Laker fan, but if I were you, I would know where it is, especially since you know Utah is looking to break your dude's faces tomorrow night. Would have been nice to win that one. Would have been nice to stop the bleeding with a 17-point lead. And they couldn't do it. Leonard Hamilton. Leonard, it's so good to have you back. You and I did speak at the beginning of the year, but let me check in with you as always. How are you doing and how is your life right about now, Coach?
Well, Jim, obviously I'm probably like a lot of coaches, just trying to stay safe, trying to get through the season, trying to make sure that your kids are being in good shape from a basketball playing standpoint, and that we are prepared to see whether or not we can finish the season without a lot of issues.
I got that. Leonard Hamilton's joining us. All right, so why don't we talk about what you have right now. You have won 3 straight, including a 21-point win over number 7, Virginia, that was the Cavaliers' worst conference loss in 4 years. So what do you make of how your team is playing at this point in the season?
Well, the good thing about our team, Jim, is that we are still developing. You know, we're not quite there yet. You know, we still got a feeling of area where we can improve in. We've been fortunate, you know, to have some experienced guys and some new that are changing roles, and we have some new guys that are coming in, learning the system. So the good thing about this team, we're finding ways to win while we're still developing.
We are talking to Leonard Hamilton. I'm going to talk about the new guys in a minute, but what's interesting to me is I mentioned off the top, the program had its first ACC regular season title in school history last year. You're back in first place in the ACC again this year, but the thing is, you're doing that having had 2 lottery picks in the 2020 draft and a third player who's with the Jazz right now. How do you explain the fact that you're filling up the NBA with that kind of talent, but the team just keeps getting better?
I think I have a great staff of guys who develop and skilled developers, and our guys are improving and getting better. And so the guys who are role players 1 year move into different roles the following year, and they're prepared mentally, emotionally, you know, to step into those roles. And we've been a little inconsistent this year because some of our new guys are kind of learning and growing, and then our new guys who are moving into different roles are still adjusting. So if we can just, like I said earlier, if we can keep winning while we're developing, I think we can be a pretty good team once we get into the postseason.
Florida State head basketball coach Leonard Hamilton is back on the show. You know, one of the terms that's used around the program is, quote, new blood, as in the guys are the new bloods. Now, when you keep having success like that, at a certain point, do you become blue bloods, or do you want to maintain that new blood mentality instead?
Well, we're probably about 75 years behind some of the blue blood statuses in our league. When you look at our conference, you know, with North Carolina, Duke, Notre Dame, Louisville, Syracuse, some of the top winning programs in the history of college basketball, those guys got 65, 70 years of successful experience ahead of us. When Florida State was in the Dixie Conference and Independent, and then the Metro, these guys were in the Big East and the ACC. So we still have a lot of ground to work up to catch up on. We're not going to ever catch up with some of these schools. So we coined our own phrase. The Blue Bloods are not inviting us to the party. So, you know, we crashing it as Blue Bloods. So, I'm sorry, as New Bloods. And that's kind of, it gives our kids a little area of their own that they can feel proud of.
I like that. Are you feeling stressed out? Probably so. Most people are. Listen, don't let the stress of daily life weigh on your body. Whether you're an elite athlete or somebody like me, just trying to make it through the day tension-free, Theragun can help. Theragun is the handheld percussive therapy device that releases your deepest muscle tension using a scientifically calibrated combo of depth, speed, and power. And it's as quiet as an electric toothbrush. This product is incredible. The Gen 4 Theragun doesn't just feel good, it gets to the source of the pain by releasing tension using Theragun's signature percussive therapy, which goes 60% deeper than vibration alone. Whether you want to treat your muscle tension from working out, or maybe you have an injury, or it's just the stresses of everyday life, there is no substitute for the Theragun Gen 4. Theragun is trusted by 250 professional sports teams like Real Madrid and elite athletes like Paul George, DeAndre Hopkins, Maria Sharapova, hundreds of thousands of customers, and myself. I have mine. I absolutely love this product. Try Theragun for 30 days, starting at only $199. Go to Theragun.com/Rome right now and get your Gen 4 Theragun today. This product is sensational. Go to Theragun.com/Rome right now. Get your Gen 4 Theragun today. The product is absolutely amazing. Once again, Theragun.com/Rome, R-O-M-E. Theragun.com/Rome. Leonard Hamilton's joining us. Now, one of your assistants, C.Y. Young, told The Athletic, quote, "Culture doesn't graduate." To me, another great line. You and I have talked about culture in the past. How do you make sure that it doesn't graduate, that it doesn't leave when you are sending guys to the NBA and guys overseas?
Well, there's no doubt that our culture is very strong because we're different. You know, we rotate more players. We play at a faster pace offensively. We still pick it up 94 feet on the defensive end. And we moving the ball, we making passes, and we playing unselfish. And so that requires you to have a deep rotation. So guys who come to our program come in with an understanding, this is what I'm looking for and this is what I want. We just try not to put a square peg in a round hole. We try to recruit guys who fit who we are and it's working. We try to avoid putting the kid in a situation that he doesn't particularly feel comfortable with. Some kids need to go somewhere where they're playing 35, 37 minutes, even when they're tired. Well, our guys play through exhaustion, and they actually come out, and they cheer for the guy who goes in and replaces them.
All right, so we're talking about culture here. Leonard Hamilton's my guest. And then part of that culture is the fact that, as Young says, you're not going to recruit every single five-star guy. Not everybody, to your point, Leonard, is going to be a good fit for the program. And you talk about humility. You and I have talked in the past, for instance, about Scotty Barnes and his humility back at the start of the season. So what do you make of how his game has grown over the course of this season?
I don't think there's anybody in college basketball has had more of a transition than Scotty Barnes. He played power forward his entire life. In other words, when most guys who are point guards at this level, they was playing point guard for their team when they was 8 years old. Scotty Barnes has made the transition seamlessly because he has a high IQ, he's humble, he's eager to learn, he's watching, he's listening to his teammates, and he is really doing a fantastic job. And he hasn't even scratched the surface of his potential. He's made the adjustment better than anybody I've ever seen in my life to go from power forward to point guard on a top 10 ranked team in the country that's number one in a Power 5 conference. That speaks for itself.
Now, I know you're not going to make it about you, and I would never look for you to make it about you, but you said recently, quote, "I don't have a whole lot of original ideas. I try to steal as much as possible." Personally, I'm not really buying this notion that you don't have a whole lot of original ideas, but who are some of the people or some of the teams that maybe you have borrowed ideas from?
Well, see, I've been very fortunate, Jim, in my career to have worked for some outstanding people. My first guy I worked for is the late Lake Kelly at Austin Peay State University. I think he was a genius, just an absolute total genius in his philosophy of basketball, and I was very fortunate to have a chance to work with him. At the beginning of my coaching career, a detailed guy who gave guys freedom, who played an unbelievable, aggressive style of basketball. And we had a chance to go in there and turn Austin Peay program around. And then I left from there and went to Kentucky, you know, the winningest program in the history of college basketball, where I picked up other ideas. And John Thompson and watching how he played, and Nolan Richardson in the 40 minutes from hell, system that he had, and I was Patino, I mean, Eddie Sutton. I mean, I have picked up things along the way. And I remember even watching John Wooten